Well, to get a sense of how the euro crisis is seen from different parts of Europe and by different parties, I'm joined by four members of the European Parliament here in Strasbourg. David Campbell Bannerman is a member of the British Conservatives delegation, recently defected, though, from the UK Independence Party. We also have Mr. Sanchez Presedo, who is from the Spanish Socialist delegation, and, of course, your party is no longer in government in Spain. Wolf Klintz is from the German Liberals, and you, of course, headed that crisis committee that disbanded last June, I think, looking at the causes of the economic crisis and lessons for the future. And we have Gay Mitchell, who leads the delegation of Fine Gael Irish centre-right MEPs, and, of course, you were Europe Minister back in Ireland for several years. Let me ask you, though, first of all, Mr. Sanchez Presedo, when you heard a few weeks ago here in this chamber, Mr. Barroso, Herman Van Rompuy, then a few days after that, Mr. Monti, all saying in one way or another, we're turning the corner, the crisis is nearly over. From a country like Spain, where you come from, what did you think?
I think that the crisis will be over when we recover the employment. This is my main concern in this moment. In Spain, we need to recover growth and we need to recover employment. We think that fiscal consolidation is needed, but fiscal consolidation needs also growth to be possible, and then we need a path to fiscal consolidation can support a strategy of employment and growth.
And of course we know that youth unemployment in Spain is currently running above 50%. Now, you're talking about a pact, but the pact that is actually on the table is the fiscal pact, which some are saying will consign people to austerity for years and years to come. Gay Mitchell, you're having to participate in your government's campaign to sell that pact to the people in a referendum at the end of May. I mean, can you really defend that?
Yes, of course we can defend it. First of all, I think what was said in Parliament was that we have turned the corner, not that the crisis is over, and I think we have turned the corner. This recession has lasted longer than any other recession that in recent years. And at some stage, I think we have to stop simply looking for the negatives and say, well, there are a lot of positives. Sometimes you have to prune the bush to make it grow. And, for example, in Ireland, there is an indication that foreign direct investment is up 30%. On what it was last year. So they are very clear signs that confidence is returning.
The problem is, though, isn't it, that one lot of medicine for one country is not necessarily the right for another? And doesn't that actually get to the core of what the problem is with the EU, let alone this particular crisis?
I'm very concerned. I remain very concerned. I think it's foolish to think it's all over and we've turned a corner, actually. It's still a perfect storm. I mean, Spain's credit rating, its ability to borrow, it's hitting 6% now, danger level 7%. Can Spain be bailed out or Italy be bailed out? These are very serious questions. And what's happened is the banks, yes, have been helped with €1 trillion, basically money being printed by the European Central Bank. I'm concerned that that money has been exchanged for junk bonds, for junk collateral.
It ought to be said that you sceptics make a lot of mileage out of this crisis, and secretly you must be quite pleased the longer it goes on.
I'm not pleased to see the pain it's caused. I'm not pleased to see that Greek gentleman shoot himself in Greece. That was appalling, in Athens. The pain in Spain, I don't celebrate that. And I do blame the euro. The actual demand of the euro and forcing together very divergent economies is the nub of the problem.
And this is the point, isn't it, that some are saying, Wolf Klintz, is that the EU, the euro, from having been something that was supposed to promote solidarity, is now actually sowing disunion. And the strategy that the EU is now proposing is actually making things worse, not better. Well, is there any truth in that, do you think?
Well, I would disagree with that statement, and I would agree with what Gay Mitchell said, that in fact the fiscal pact is the right approach to fight the crisis. However, it's not the only. There is still one element missing. Mm-hmm. And that element, of course, and our Spanish friend alluded to that, is, of course, what can we do to stimulate growth? Because without growth, you know, savings alone will not do the trick. This we do know. But the problem that we are facing right now is not caused to the euro per se. It's caused to the lack of discipline. We should, you know, call a spade a spade. It was that, you know, out of the 17, probably 13 or 14 did not play the rules of the game. And that's why we got into the trouble. But back to the growth. Now, the difference when it comes to how to stimulate growth between the political groups is that one say you should inject even more money. And I agree with you. We have already injected more than a billion. It's worrying. At the end of the day, we are going to have even higher. We have a straw fire. We are going to have higher debt, higher inflation, and higher unemployment. So it's a structural problem. It's not a cyclical problem. It's a structural problem. So we need structural reforms. And I see too little structural reforms in Spain, in Greece, in Portugal, and even in France. And therefore, I'm worried too.
Mr. Sanchez-Presedo, do you agree with that analysis?
The problems in Spain are and were very different from the problems in
absolutely.
Greece. That's obviously
exactly.
Often not
the problems in Ireland and the problems in Portugal. We have, above all, a bubble problem, and we need to address the problems of the bubble. And we are in this line. The Zapatero government adopted a number of reforms, and the present government must continue. But the question that we are very concerned is we need a proper path to fiscal consolidation that allows us to promote also reforms that can conduce to recover growth and employment, because it's the way to ensure that debt can be paid. And then we need measures, and in Spain, citizens are asking what European Union can, how European Union can support our efforts to achieve our recuperation.
And how can the European Union support these efforts? Because some people say that the fiscal pact, which essentially demands more discipline, as you want, and it is very much coming from Germany being one of the driving forces, actually doesn't allow for public spending and actually the decision by individual governments to invest towards.
But if you take the case in Ireland, for example, the government is overspent, so we can't spend anymore in any event. We borrowed too much. So we have to get our house in order, and we are doing that with a lot of pain. But one of the outcomes of that has been that Ireland in the public sector and in the private sector has become much more competitive. The Minister for Finance, Michael Noonan, speaking in Paris on St. Patrick's Day, 17th of March, said that when Ireland takes off, it could really take off very quickly because of that discipline. Now, when you ask about what can the Union do, I think, first of all, the Union has to stop this vocabulary of austerity, and we need to start talking about hope, jobs, the future, why we're doing this. Not just that we're doing this, why we're doing this. And secondly, when countries become competitive and do take the medicine, there should be targeted support for those countries to show this is what works.
The problem with the EU is not what people say. I mean, there's been more words, you know, per minute than anywhere else. And growth and growsterity is the latest slogan. But it's actually what the EU does.
Well, I think
there
is a problem. I might just make this point. There is just one problem, and it is that the IMF used to be the bad initials. Now the IMF are people talking about growth and investment. The EU has become the sort of austere father in the corner. Yes. We have to show that austerity is for a reason.
That's partly the fault of Germany, though, isn't
it? Well, if we call people to respect discipline, that doesn't mean that they should not do what has to be done, i.e. restructure reforms. You can do a lot without having to spend a single euro. You can complete the single market, including services sector. You can open up market sectors that are still being protected. You can flexibilize the labor market. You can reduce bureaucracy. All of those will stimulate growth.
Because who's the we?
Are the countries. Those are the countries. That is not the EU. It's the responsibility of the member states to take those, implement those necessary reforms.
But you see, Ireland's benefited from corporation tax. That's been, you know, your ability, your freedom to keep your corporation tax low has quite rightly driven a lot of growth, and Britain is following your example to some extent. But, you know, if you lost that freedom, as the EU has advocated, more tax harmonisation, that's a different issue.
First of all, David, the EU hasn't advocated that. Parliament has Parliament is only consulted
on
this.
Most member states want to see you do away with your level of separation. It doesn't matter if most member states,
which I dispute because I've seen the figures in council. This is something that requires unanimity. And I can't see Britain, Cyprus, Malta, Poland, or Spain for that matter, maybe when it comes to Germany and France, voting to harmonise
tax. It's like
tax
the financial
rates.
Transaction tax. But let me just move on to another tax. It isn't just strategy that is one of the major issues here. It's also these more fundamental questions about democracy. And, you know, you may have the prescription for the rest of Europe, but the fact is even your own constitutional court is rather unhappy about the way the EU is pushing through from the top down rather than the bottom up. And in Spain, of course, we've seen the announcement of your government this week that it wants to take powers away from regional governments. Is this an issue, do you think?
Yes. This is a very important question because the crisis needs to be addressed with legitimacy. And then at European level, we need that the Parliament must be involved in the economic governance at the European level, because we need that the representatives of citizens must be involved. At the same time, the national parliaments and the regional powers are a part important of the European system of governance, and they must cooperate to address these objectives. But my concern is one thing is diet, another different thing is anorexia. And then in this moment, the political of the European Union is more conducive to the analysis than to the solve of problems of growth at European level.
I mean, I find it concerning if you override democracy, which you're having to do in Spain. I understand why, and I understand why in Greece and in Italy it was done as well. But if you override democracy, then you don't get the buy-in from your people. So in the regions, you may not get that buy-in, and then you get blamed. And the consequences of that lack of democracy are very serious, I think, in my
opinion. I think, on the other hand, we should not forget the situation in the UK, since you're not a member of the Eurozone, maybe slightly different from Spain and others. Those that are members of the Euro have decided that they want to have a joint currency and a single monetary policy, as difficult as it may be. And that is the conclusion also of our special committee that's looked into the financial crisis. We have to have, if we want to keep the euro and keep it as a successful currency, we have to have more Europe in some areas. I'm not saying in all and every area, but in some areas. And that economic policy, some aspects of fiscal policy, and even some aspects of social policy.
Yes, but there is a debate about what that should look like. And at the moment, that debate is being rather monopolised by the centre-right vision. Now, that may well change after the French elections.
It could well change. You know, somebody has to take the lead, so to speak. I think what has been decided and what those things that have not yet been decided by on the table, you know, have been discussed in the group of 17 or 27.
Back to this issue of democracy, though, Gay Mitchell, you're carrying out this referendum in Ireland. Do you think that you may suffer as the party that's pushing for the EU's strategy on the table from the perception that people have? As you're saying, Mr. Sanchez Presedo, that these things are being sort of rather forced on people. There isn't enough discussion and democracy about it.
First of all, can I say that I thought it a little bit amusing that David should lecture Antolin on democracy inside Spain. I mean, British have one House of Parliament that's appointed and another that's elected by a minority. So I think there's much more democracy out here than there are in some of the member states. My issue is not about things that are done by community decision, where we agree them and then they're implemented. My issue is intergovernmentalism. At one stage, we had to wait on an election in Finland before we could agree on some of the interest rate issues. And now we have the presidential election in France. And then there'll be something going on in Germany. It's intergovernmentalism, going by the slowest ship in the convoy, which in this case is often one of the larger member states.
But I mean, some would argue waiting for the Finnish parliament, actually. So in a sense, you know, it's just the European parliamentarians
The point I'm making is that if we have to wait for 27 parliaments all of the time, we agreed in the treaties that we've agreed to date, these are the things that the European Union can do together. If it's not stated in the treaties, it's for the member states. Everything else is for the member states. But when we agree to do these things together, we should do them together. By 2050, within a generation, we will be 6% of the world's population. We cannot continue to take the decisions intergovernmentally. The more there is of Europe by agreement, and then that's implemented, the better for everybody.
Well, there's a huge price in democracy, as you found with you lost two of your referendum in Ireland because the Irish people, quite rightly, felt they were being overridden, and they had the democratic right to actually say no, and they did say no. So I think there is a price, and if you're not careful, if you don't get the balance right, then there will be trouble, like in Greece on the streets, because there's no democratic way of actually expressing that worries or those anxieties.
We can vote briefly against the treaty, but we have to take the consequences of voting against the treaty.
Most member states, we have a representative democracy. You know, it's the chosen or elected politicians that have to assume the responsibility. We've had in Germany three decisions that were clearly against the majority of the people. Joining NATO in the 50s, Ostpolitik under Willy Brandt, and introducing the euro. We would have clearly a huge majority against those decisions. In hindsight, those decisions proved to be vital and important and right.
Well, on that note, we'll have to leave it there. Thanks very much. And let's have a look now at what else has been going on here in Strasbourg this week.